It was Wednesday, October 24, 1928, when a boy named Seyyed Mohammad, one of influential figures of the late 20th century, was born in an old neighborhood of Isfahan, central Iran. His father, Seyyed Fazlullah, was a teacher at a seminary, and every day he went from a village to another to offer congregational prayers. The little boy was gifted with such a wit that he started school at the age of 4. Seyyed Mohammad passed the 6th grade entrance exam, but was accepted to the 4th because of his young age. Since August 1941, when he was a sophomore at high school, he forged closer bonds with the students of religious schools, getting more and more interested in attending a seminary. Therefore, in 1942, at the age of 14, he dropped out of high school and went to Sadr Madrasa, one of the most prominent Islamic schools in his hometown. However, studying at the university never lost its appeal in the heart of Seyyed Mohammad. In 1948, he switched higher education at the Faculty of Theology at the University of Tehran. In 1965, Seyyed Mohammad traveled to Germany, starting his career as the director of Hamburg Islamic Center, where he delivered keynote speeches both in English and German. He raised so many new issues never heard before, such as exploring relations between the science and Islam. His opinions drew attention of many students, scholars, and even ordinary people. The first meeting of the Union Islamic Student Association in Europe was held in Germany, a short while upon his arrival in the country. Such meetings, however, grabbed the attention of SAVAK, which was a Persian acronym for the National Organization for Security and Intelligence during the reign of the Shah. Consequently, Seyyed Mohammad was arrested upon his arrival in motherland in 1970. He was banned from leaving the country by the order of SAVAK to be under close inspection. His coherent ideology, however, opposed to that of Pahlavi regime, a driving factor that led him to fight against the fierce monarchy of the Shah. His resistance caused him to be arrested and jailed for several times. The nation's fight, in which Seyyed Mohammad Hosseini Beheshti had a significant role, paid off in early 1979, when the Shah left Iran forever.
With the speed of the human shout, Shah Farari Shode, the people cried, the Shah has escaped.
What is the meaning of it? The meaning is that they're hoping that there will be free country from now on. They're hoping that, you know, U.S. support of the Shah has not had any effect. You know. So, you can see it.
Since the very beginning of the Islamic Revolution, Seyyed Mohammad stood by Imam Khomeini, the founder of Islamic Republic. By the order of Imam, and under the auspices of Murtaza Mutahhari, Mohammad Javad Bahonar, Akbar Hashemi Rafsanjani, and a number of prominent figures of the Islamic Revolution, Beheshti inaugurated the Revolutionary Council and served as its secretary himself. In another tireless effort, Beheshti formed the Islamic Republican Party with the help of illustrious figures such as Ayatollah Seyyed Ali Khamenei, Akbar Hashemi Rafsanjani, Mohammad Javad Bahonar, and Seyyed Abdul Karim Musavi. In that time, the very young revolution was still facing countless challenges. For instance, political unrest erupted in every corner of the country. And on the international scene, there were many countries and opposing groups that did not tolerate the novel ideology of the Islamic Republic. One of such noticeable tensions emerged in Kurdistan, which was brought to an end with the intervention of Beheshti and several officials of the time. In addition, Beheshti played a key role in drafting the Iranian constitution. He further served as the chairman of Assembly of Experts as well. In the very first months following the victory of Islamic Revolution, it was extremely felt that Iran needed a tool to elaborate on lofty ideals of the Islamic Revolution outside borders, especially those who had pinned their hopes on the revolution. One of the remarkable points about Beheshti's character was his familiarity with the mass media and its vast impact on public opinion. He had lived in Europe for a while, and he was well aware of the pivotal role of media in a society. Founding an English language newspaper sounded a good idea that Beheshti put into practice less than a year since the victory of Islamic Revolution. He established the Tehran Times. Beheshti regarded the daily as the loud voice of the Islamic Revolution, saying, "The Tehran Times is not the newspaper of the government, but it must be a loud voice of the Islamic Revolution and the loudspeaker of the oppressed people of the world." In Iran, the people revolted for independence and freedom from the Shah's dictatorship and American domination, he said. "The Shah is gone, but there is still American media domination over the world." For Beheshti, this was an ever-ending fight ahead of the Islamic Revolution, which required its own weapon. The Tehran Times was that certain weapon that could convey the Iranian nation's voice beyond the borders. So the Tehran Times was born. Until the last moments of his life, Ayatollah Beheshti was always taking part in various activities to strengthen the Islamic Republic and made every effort to thwart attempts by enemies and ill-wishers of the Iranian nation. There were many individuals and groups that could not bear Beheshti's ideology. An assassination plot prepared. It was an ordinary Sunday at about 9 p.m. June 28, 1981. Beheshti was a meeting in the central office of the Islamic Republican Party along with a group of officials and parliamentarians. Only a few minutes after the beginning of the meeting, a horrible sound filled the sky above the city. The blast was so powerful that shook almost entire the city of Tehran. The building collapsed, and Beheshti, along with 72 others present at the meeting, were murdered. The Islamic Revolution of Iran lost one of its most influential figures. However, his soul is present wherever he set foot, like here at the Tehran Times.